Good old Dave Rubin has been trying to play the sellout card for quite a while now, a couple years now, where he is basically trying to play the card of, hey, look, I used to be part of the Suppression Olympics, or at least it's something that he used to be a witness of and decided to stray away from it because of how dangerous and ridiculous it was. And he's basically spent a long time now trying to argue against real systems of oppression that do exist. Most importantly, being systemic oppression that exists in the United States, which means that there aren't laws on the books that are directly discriminatory, but rather that it surfaces in the expression of the basically social and political institutions that exist. So that can be, the justice system, for example, and it can just be different areas of society. So he here is doing some interview with some guy. He's with Jordan Peterson because he has been riding that money train for a while now. I don't think Dave Rubin can be away from Jordan Peterson and by himself for 24 hours, or else he gets scared about his pockets running out of money. But I'm sure they charge this guy a lot of money to do this, probably like 50 G's. But anyways, what you're gonna see here is he's going to offer his genius explanation. And refute the concept of oppression existing. Check it out.
Well, I think there's an interesting reason for that that sort of brings the Solzhenitsyn story into 2019, which is that he was truly oppressed. This was a life of actual oppression, right? Now we have people that are walking around. Everyone in this room has this in their pocket. And if you have this in your pocket and you
turned
think,
off, I hope.
Yeah, hopefully turned off. But if you have this thing in your pocket and you think you're oppressed, you're very confused. We live in a time with such absurd freedoms in the West that are so beyond imagination of what people could only dream of two generations ago, even one generation ago, especially with this, that people now have a perceived oppression instead of a real oppression. So one of the things that I find when I go to college campuses is that, these kids will protest and they'll scream. And I always find, all right, well, how do you break through to somebody like that? How do you actually, when they have, you've talked about this, when they have that look in their eye, truly a possessed look, and they're, it's this postmodern monster has become sort of a secular religion. And I think that's also one of the reasons why what Jordan's doing is resonating, because they've removed religion from the equation and now they have no meaning, and they put it all into this really competing set of ideas, what we call the oppression Olympics, where they're constantly competing for oppression because they believe that victimhood is virtue, and victimhood, of course, is not virtue. What's virtuous is getting your life in order and going out and doing something. So I'm always looking for a little trick to get through to these kids, and it's really hard because when they have that sort of glossed over zombie look, it's tough. And I found one trick that actually kind of works if you can get it to them in the most simple personal way. And this particularly works in the United States, and I have no doubt that it would work here in Australia as well. I'll say to them, anyone in this room, does anyone in this room have it worse than their grandparents? Now, I've done this, I don't know, 100 times probably. Nobody has ever raised their hand. Nobody ever. If you live in the United States, you basically, the only outsider case would be if your grandparents were oil barons or something like that, and then they lost all the money, in which case the leftists would actually love that too, because it would show that, well, it would show that that accumulated wealth doesn't stay beyond generations, so they're all about that, right? So, but if you can do something like that, everyone in this room can do it. Like, can everyone picture their grandparents? Do you have it better or worse? I mean, does anyone in here have it worse than their grandparents? And that shows you that it's a perceived oppression, not a real oppression, that the thing that they're fighting, this patriarchal, postmodern, capitalistic thing that they're fighting, I mean, they can't define it, so it's hard to define it for them, that it actually has bent toward justice always, always. And if you can plant that seed in them, I think it's a little bit of something. But it's very hard to break them out of that. But I think the key here is understanding that it's a perceived oppression. If you live in a free society in the West in 2019, you're not oppressed. You maybe don't have it as well as your neighbor does, and maybe you came from more and they came from less, or maybe you're sick and they're not, or a series of other things. But you've got a chance, and that's all you're supposed to have in life. And I think getting that through to them, as opposed to, oh, the system is horrible and I have to now destroy the system, as if they could magically reconstitute a system that really would just be, in effect, throwing away thousands of years of human history, that they're so wise. They're so wise at 24 years old as they're shouting down speakers that they could build up what nobody before them could. And that's the danger there. So I think getting them to think about their own lives, where they come from, I think is a pretty effective way of getting through to people.
Well, we could also say, like,
is there anybody on the entire planet who watched that and came away with the conclusion that, you know, they agree with Dave Rubin, and the David Rubin was very convincing there, and he rolled out an extremely intelligent, amazing, truly awesome argument there? That's one of the lamest, dumbest arguments I've ever heard in my entire life. So he pulls out an iPhone, a smartphone is what he's trying to represent. And he's basically saying, hey, you know, if you pull out a phone, that means that you are not oppressed. It's perceived, it's non-existent, it's not real. And, you know, there are some people who go too far in that realm, in my opinion, but to act as if systemic oppression doesn't exist, you're at odds, and you're going to, you know, have to go to war with mathematics, because the statistics that we've shown show that, and study after study consistently come out showing that, you know, African Americans are given harsher sentences for the same crime in a lot of cases. And David Rubin has even admitted to this. He said this himself. He did this in his Oxford Union talk, where he literally says that, you know, systemic oppression doesn't exist. And then, like, 5 seconds later, he's like, oh, but, you know, and he rolls out an exact example. So the guy doesn't know anything about, you know, basic definitions of these kinds of things. He doesn't know what he's talking about. But those things are specifically discrepancies that exist due to the oppression that is, you know, expressed through the political and social institutions that exist in our country. So the Booker Report, I forget how many every year it comes out. I think it's like every couple years or something like that, every 4 or 6 years it comes out, and it consistently has shown, and other studies have come out showing that African Americans will get harsher sentences for the same crime, controlling for all factors. Also, they're more likely to be given a charge that deals with a mandatory minimum sentence, and a lot of this has to do with the judge having a lot more leeway due to the Supreme Court case. I think it's Booker v. something, and it gave judges more leeway, and they didn't have to be part of such strict guidelines. So that became a problem, and, you know, the charges that are given are clearly, you know, disproportionately harsher for African Americans. These are numbers that exist. They're not, you know, you can't just pull out an iPhone and be like, you know, well, this kind of thing doesn't exist anymore. By the way, there are also studies that actually show that black people with black sounding names, controlling for all factors, actually are less likely to get a callback than somebody with either the exact same control for factors, and sometimes it's even slightly below, and they're more likely to get a callback for a job. So this is very real stuff, and just because you have a smartphone doesn't mean that any of this doesn't exist. If you are somebody who is, you know, impoverished, and you end up being a victim of systemic oppression, which exists, just because you pull out a smartphone doesn't mean that that doesn't exist. That's just simply not the case. And it's a hilariously stupid argument that, and I read someone say something like, I read this on Reddit, someone was like, oh, you know, I wonder if Jordan Peterson brings Dave Rubin so that he can make himself look even smarter, because Dave Rubin is not someone who can, you know, really give you any serious thoughts in a good way, or in a very, you know, just a persuasive way, in a concise way. He just ends up saying a bunch of baloney and a bunch of just, you know, nonsense slopped together. That's what Dave Rubin does. And it's because Dave Rubin's supposed to be an interviewer, and his thoughts are very, very stupid, as we just saw there. And I think there's another clip of him in some interview with some Daily Wire lady where he says that Trump is more of a centrist than the other Democratic candidates, which is absolute insanity, to say the least. And then he says that, you know, well, you know, I asked these kids, well, did your grandparents have it harder than you did? How does that refute anything? Like, this is a bunch of random whataboutism crap. I don't even know if this qualifies as whataboutism. It's just verbal nonsense, like verbal garbage is what this is. What does that have to do with whether or not systemic oppression exists in the United States? That's not a convincing argument. It doesn't add up. It's just, what does that have to do with that? So we're talking about looking at evidence from the Booker Report, other studies. What does the question of whether or not your grandparents had it better than you refute in terms of whether or not oppression exists? Doesn't make any sense whatsoever. This guy is a total doofus. And then he also throws in there like this postmodern monster. Stop using that term postmodernism. By the way, guys, there was a Reddit. Remember when he had that total catastrophe that was his Reddit, AMA that he did where he got flooded with a bunch of like rational questions from rational people? One of the questions was basically, you know, do you think Trump is a big problem or something like that? And then his answer was, no, I think the bigger problem is postmodernism. Postmodernism, by the way, has nothing to do with anything, because what they try to do is they try to lump in postmodernists. Not only do they lump in Marxists, they lump in the McFeminists and those fake gender people who are supposedly like these feminists. They lump all of those people together and somehow say that they're postmodernists, when Marxism, modernism and postmodernism are superbly different, and that modernism basically is like, it has more to do with universalities, whereas postmodernism is the complete opposite. So you're just jumbling Marxism into postmodernism, which they're totally the opposite. Postmodernism and Marxism, those two things, first of all, Marxism was modernism, wasn't postmodernism, and then the postmodernism, there's those two things are at complete odds with each other. So that term is a total BS nonsense term that doesn't actually mean anything, and so that's why it gets so annoying when he says that every time. And I've noticed that it's gone lower. The usage for that term has gotten lower amongst him and his buddy Peterson, but nevertheless, it seems like that still persists. But let me know if you were convinced by his argument. I'm just kidding. I know that you're not. I mean, just because you pull out an iPhone doesn't mean that systemic oppression doesn't exist.